Imagine getting three calls every single day from a buyer or seller that wants to hire you. That's exactly what Will Friedner, a broker up in Whitefish, Montana, is getting, and it's coming from his YouTube channel. He's been YouTubing for less than a year. He's had a video get 1.6 million views in just the last 6 months, and he's now getting three organic phone calls every single day from people that want to hire him specifically. Let's hear how he did it. All right, guys, I'm here with Will Friedner, a broker up in Whitefish, Montana, doing some really cool stuff with YouTube, and it's opened a lot of doors for him, and wanted to hear his story. But Will and I actually go way back. Will, did we meet on Snapchat?
Well, yes, that's where I got to know you. And then we eventually met up in San Diego at the Social Media Marketing World Conference. And I don't remember what year that was, but it was a while ago.
That's right. That was 2016 or 2017.
Sounds about right.
Yep. Yeah. That was a while ago, and a lot's changed since. and what's changed is a lot of what I wanted to talk to you about, because you're doing some really cool stuff, and I'm blown away at some of the accomplishments that you've had over the last year. And, you know, it started with decisions you made prior, and, you know, you're seeing payoff now. So, you know, before we go down that road too much, and I don't want to give the end away quite yet. Before you started doing content marketing, how are you getting business? Like, what did your real estate business look like? And, you know, and even before that, take 30 seconds or so and just kind of like let people know who you are, where you're from, and, you know, how you do business.
Yeah, my wife and I are in business together, and we started about, I think, 12 years ago now. And when we first got in, we were like everybody else. And, you know, 12 years ago, believe it or not, social media wasn't really a thing. it was coming, but it wasn't a huge marketing venue or whatever you want to call it for real estate.
We didn't even have iPhones 12 years ago, right?
What's that?
You didn't even have iPhones when you started in the industry, right?
You're probably right. I am kind of a dinosaur.
Well, I've been in the industry for 10 years, and let's see, iPhones came out in what, 2007, 8-ish?
Yeah, so, that's about right. That's right about when we got into the business. But we just did it, you know, the old fashioned way and the way I hate. And I'm very thankful that social media and everything came up, because I hate door knocking. I've never door knocked, because I won't. I just don't have that personality, and I cold calling, all of it, I just didn't like. So yeah. We were fortunate that when we first got into the business, my wife's very first listing was buyer was for a bank owned house. And that, unfortunately, we got into the business right during the last crash. And we were like, I wonder how that agent got that bank owned listing. And so we spent the next 2 weeks signing up online for every bank in the country. And we, you know, got lucky, because we were, I don't know if anybody else was doing it at the time. And all of a sudden, a couple months later, we were getting a ton of listings that were all bank owned. So that's kind of how we broke into the business. And we did pretty well, even during the downturn, because of that. So,
wow. And obviously, it's a very different market than it was then. Yeah. There's a lot of new agents now that don't know what the hell an REO is. They think it's a band.
Yeah.
And it is, but that's not what we're talking about. You know, bank-owned properties were everywhere in Salt Lake in 2011, 2012, when I was starting out in the business. And it's like, now you can't even find an expired property, for God's sakes. So, very different world. When did you get into content marketing, and what did that look like? Did you start with YouTube, or weren't you doing some blogging prior to that?
No, I guess, I had a website, and I guess it's not really content marketing per se, I guess, but the first thing that got me into it was, when Facebook started having groups, I was lucky enough again to get in early, and I just started a page or a group in my area called Flathead Valley Homes for Sale or Rent. And the first day got 100 subscribers organically. They just, you know, it just took off. And then I, you know, after a few weeks of it taking off, I was like, you know, I've always been fortunate. Montana's always seems to be 5 years behind everyone else. And, you know, not that I'm Al Einstein or anything, but I've just been always trying to be in front of everything. And so with the Montana real estate license, obviously I can sell real estate anywhere in Montana. So I started groups all around the state, or, you know, I started three others in the big cities around the state. And I just use those for referrals. And I added it up this morning. Now I have 33,600 people in those four groups. And it's been great. And that's a whole other story that, you know, that, you know, I have never let other agents into the groups, and they're all, you know, it's my lead generation thing. And so, yeah, I guess that was the start of my so-called content marketing.
Yeah. What's funny, I totally glanced over that whole chapter of you dominating online, but you're right. Like 30,000 plus members of a group, which isn't that like the entire population of Montana, Will?
it is a good percentage of the population of Montana.
Yes. So you created these Facebook groups and you wouldn't let other agents in. I've done that with my local, you know, homes for sale or rent group as well, which I modeled after yours. And, you know, it's your group. You can do whatever the hell you want. What kind of content were you doing in that group? Like, so you created the group, how are you keeping people there, and what were you giving them to, you know, as a reason to join?
Well, again, I think the reason they were successful is because I was very low key. I was not posting my listings and, you know, talking about how great I am and things that agents have a tendency to do. And that's why I didn't want them in my group, because then the regular people that I was targeting would bail. You know, as you know, there's a million groups out there. And there's a million realtor groups, and they always end up just spam. And so nobody spends time in there. So again, that's why I say, I don't know if this is really content marketing. I guess for a while there, I did a weekly show on my groups when you could do live. And that's kind of what the YouTube channel evolved from. But that was the content. And occasionally I would, you know, the articles I wrote on my website, I would post them on that, in that group. But I really laid low. And I think the reason they grew is because people felt like it was their own group and they weren't being bugged by an agent, and they could promote their own FSBOs or, you know, looking for rentals, whatever they were doing, without, you know, 100 agents piling on and, you know.
Yeah. It was a safe space.
Yeah.
Yeah. That is content marketing. I mean, even though it's not one of those more traditional methods that we talk about with YouTube or blogging or podcasting or Instagram stories, creating content within a Facebook group that you own, that's a big deal. And how did that, like, what did that look like business-wise? You know, once you started that Facebook group, what did that do for you?
It took a while. It wasn't an overnight thing, and it took a while to grow to where it is now, these groups. And I'll be completely honest, in the past year, ever since the YouTube thing took off, I have been not as good as keeping up with the Facebook groups, because the YouTube has kind of blown them away as far as leads and everything. But when I started and it started to pick up, the thing I noticed, and I'm sure you get this all the time, and I remember when we went to San Diego together, people that I had been watching online, yourself, Chelsea, other people like that, when I remember the first day I ran into all you guys, it was like, oh my God, I can't believe I'm talking to Dustin or Chelsea or whoever. And then I remember that night in my hotel room thinking, why am I all giddy about these people? They're just average dudes from Salt Lake. but it's because I've been watching them on this screen, so that they're like TV stars. And, you know, I get that now too, which just cracks me up because I'm the farthest thing from a TV star that you'll ever meet. But people, because they've been watching me on my channel, they're just like, oh, I can't believe I'm talking to you. And it's just weird.
Isn't that wild? It's, and it's so powerful though, because like who we see as a quote unquote celebrity, like that, it's the screen. Mm-hmm. We think they're a celebrity because we're on this screen that we consume whatever it is they're on, whether that's a movie, maybe they're a radio host, a podcast host, a YouTube host, whatever. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. You created a YouTube channel to talk about Montana, and now people who watch that, you are now their celebrity. And you know, maybe in fairness, they're not looking at you like you're Brad Pitt or something, but in their world, they recognize you from the screen. And to them, they're like, oh, cool. Like this person is like they're credible. They're an authority figure, so to speak. They're somebody that I've learned something from, somebody that's taught me something. And so they respect you and look up to you in the way that they would, you know, a movie star or you know, an actor on a TV show or something. So it's the same thing. And you created it, which is incredible. So Will, when did you decide that YouTube was going to be your next foray into content marketing, or the next step in the evolution of what you were doing from your blog, your Facebook groups, and then YouTube? Like, do you remember when you decided or why you decided to do it?
I don't remember the day exactly.
What was the weather like?
Yeah. it was last February 20th.
Yeah.
Wanted to do a YouTube channel, and I, like everybody else, I was a little hesitant to get on camera and, you know, face the possible negative comments or feedback. But I just thought, you know what, I just need to start it, and I need to give it at least 6 months.
Yeah.
See what happens. And so I just made a commitment that I was going to do a video once a week. I had done a lot of, you know, scoping around and webinars, I do a lot of my own research. I hate to spend money on these gurus or whatever you want to call them. So I do a lot of my own research and just figure stuff out. And, you know, maybe I could have been better quicker if I would have gone the regular route. But so I just decided to do it, and I started doing it. And you've heard this a million times. My first videos are horrid. I mean, even now I know my videos aren't great, but I think that's part of and I've heard this from people that have contacted me. They're like, oh, you're so real. And you know, it's not fake. And I've seen guys that spend tons of money on making these Hollywood type productions, but they're not really providing any value other than, you know, it's good video, or it's, you know, a nice drone shot or whatever. But what I've learned with YouTube is that because it's the second biggest search engine, when you're moving somewhere, people, you know, yes, they'll read a blog and they'll look at pictures and all that, but people want to see what it's like. You know, if I'm moving to Little Rock, Arkansas, let's say, I've never been there. So I'm going to get on YouTube to see somebody like myself or anybody that's, you know, filmed the downtown area or wherever I'm going to live, because you can read all the blogs in the world, but they're not going to give you the, you know, I don't know if I heard this somewhere or whatever, but I always say that, you know, a picture's worth 1,000 words, but a video's worth 1,000,000 words, because it puts you there.
And makes sense. Yeah.
That's what has made my channel do so well. And, because if you watch my videos, I know you've seen a couple, but they are not Hollywood productions. I've filmed every video I have with my iPhone. You know, I did upgrade. My wife got me the 12 plus this Christmas.
Got to have those three cameras, Will. It's very important. You can't be with two.
And that's what I use. And I see these other guys or these gurus, oh, you need this, you need that. And I just, whatever.
The canon, you know, blah, blah, blah. And like, it's all nice to have, right?
Yeah.
You don't need it.
Yep.
Yeah.
So as long as you're providing the value and putting out information that people are looking for, you will succeed. That's all you need to know. I just saved you a bunch of money on all these classes. That's all you need to know.
That's it. And I have watched some of your videos, including your viral one, which I want to talk about in a sec, because that's just amazing. And you're right. There's a realness to it. It's not, you know, they're not Hollywood productions. It's you, and you're just like giving raw truth. And you're like, you're even like, are you sure you want to move to Montana? Cause here's what it's really like, you know, not necessarily talking them out of it, but just giving them some realistic stuff to consider that they're probably not, especially if they haven't ever been there. And so I think it works because it's that real look at what it's like in Montana, what it feels like, because you can't get that from reading an article. You've got to get what it feels like from a video. And you've just done so well. So I as you were talking, I pulled up your Living in Montana YouTube channel, 37,600 subscribers, lifetime 2.8 million lifetime views with 57 videos.
Yeah, we're still not at a year.
That's incredible. 2.8 million views in just 57 videos, 110,000 views in the last 30 days on 4 videos. It's nuts. So how soon after you started this YouTube strategy did it feel like, okay, this is working? And did you start getting business from it? Let's talk about that. Like, when did it click and you're like, yes, this is the path I need to go down?
Well, I started at the beginning of April last year. And again, those first videos are just brutal.
I encourage everyone listening to go watch them, every single one. Yeah.
If you're like, well, how in the hell does this guy get anybody watching? But I guess it must have been about, so I started in April, July, I started getting calls. But hey, I'm watching your video and I have a question. So right then I was like, it is working.
Sweet.
You know, and I did not have any videos that, you know, at that point, I guess like everybody, you think, oh, I'm going to make all kinds of money on the YouTube, you know, I'm going to be a YouTube guy and
monetize them.
So you have to get 1,000 subscribers and 4,000 hours watch time within 12 months. And that was my goal. And I had built up, and I don't know if you want to go here yet, but
we'll go wherever you want, my friend.
I have been building up, and in the end of the summer last year, I was at around 600 subscribers, and I don't know how many hours watch time. It was on pace with that, whatever that means. And I thought, I'll probably get the 12 months. I'll be able to monetize. I'm on pace, you know. And then the viral one hit, and that was the end of that. I mean, not that it was the end of it. It was the beginning, but it just... I then hit 1,000 subscribers in like 2 days. So it was nothing. That was the thing that made everything take off.
So how long? Okay. So which video was it that you got over 1 million views on?
Yeah, it's called Living in Montana, Things They Don't Tell You.
Okay. So tell us the story of that. And did you know that that was going to be the one? Did it feel like it was going to? And when did it really start to take off?
Well, the reason for that video is, like I said, I was starting to get calls and get legitimate leads. And I've told these people, so it's not, you know, I'm not talking behind their back. They know that the video was because of them. They called me from, they were living in Los Angeles. They had been living there their whole life. And they were like, because of COVID and the lockdowns, and they're like, we have to get out of here. And we've been watching your videos and we want to buy something up there. And like I said earlier, I tell people, well, you need to come up here. Okay, we're leaving tomorrow. It's like, okay. And 2 days later, sure enough, they're sitting in my office, and they had picked out this house that for those of you that haven't been to Montana, we have some areas here that are way out, like in the lower 48. I don't know if you can get further away from civilization than you can in some places in Montana. And they found a house that they, you know, they wanted to be 180 different from LA. And I was like, guys, you don't get it. And they're like, no, we want to look at this house. And I said, okay. So we get in the car and we drive an hour and a half out of town, and we're 10 miles up this Forest Service road on the way to this house. And they were following me in their car. And so I pulled over before we even got there, and I walked back and their eyes are just huge. And I said, this is August. What are you guys going to do in January up here? And they're like, yeah, this is, we had no idea this, what, you know? And I was like, this is what I was telling you. And so
they have
then
no concept,
the,
do they?
Yeah, no. And no. That's, I get it. I understand that if you haven't been here, you need to come up here before you decide you're going to be live in the backwoods, because it's not like anything else. And so on my drive back to my office, I'm thinking, you know, I should do a video just warning people about this. And so the next day I got in my car and I drove out, you know, in this valley that we are here, which is nothing like where we were, but I just did a backdrop against the mountains and I just stood on the side of the road and told it like it is and warned people that, hey, you know, it wasn't why you shouldn't move here. It was just warning people that we have bears here. We, you know, the winters, the snow, there's no cell service there. You know, there's a lot of things that people don't understand. And that was the premise for the video. And you asked earlier if I knew it was the one. I had no idea. I mean, it was just a video I shot, and I tell my wife and people all the time, had I known that was going to be the video, I probably would have dressed better.
You dressed perfectly well. Yeah. okay, so I have your channel up, and I sorted it by your most popular videos. And I think it would do everyone listening a favor if we just kind of like went through some of the titles of these videos, because a lot of people get stuck with, okay, I need to do this, but what the hell should I do? And then I have a topic, but how do I, like, what do I call it? What do I title it so that I can get the most out of it? And you've done a really good job. So for anyone watching on YouTube, I'm going to share the screen real quick so you can see this. And okay, so your Living in Montana Things They Don't Tell You video is 1.6 million views, published 6 months ago. That's just wild. The next most popular is Montana versus Idaho Cost of Living, over 250,000 views. Then 85,000 views, Living in Montana Off the Grid. You've got top 10 reasons to move to Whitefish with 85,000 views. The danger of using Zillow in Montana. How much does a home cost in Montana? Why does this work so well on YouTube where it wouldn't really on Facebook or IGTV or something like that? I don't think most people who aren't actively doing YouTube, I don't think they understand the fundamental difference between YouTube and the other social media platforms. Do you want to talk about that?
Well, I think, and this is my opinion, but, and this isn't an opinion, but YouTube is the second biggest search engine behind Google. And like I said earlier, people that are moving somewhere or trying to learn about an area, they want to be there. They want to see it. And reading an article doesn't take you there really. And so I think that's why YouTube is the way to go. I think, I mean, yeah, nobody can,
searching for it.
At this point, nobody's going to convince me that, oh, you should switch to Instagram, it's better. Or, you know, and again, nothing against Instagram. It's just, I've had success beyond belief with YouTube, so there's no way you could ever convince me differently.
Well, like you said, YouTube is a search engine. Instagram's a social network. Facebook is a social network. Yes, you can search for Facebook videos, but it's not nearly the same algorithm and everything that YouTube is. The reason why those particular topics work so well on YouTube is because that's where people go to search for those topics. Simple as that. No one goes to Instagram TV to search for top 10 reasons to move to Whitefish, Montana. Yep. They just don't. But they go to YouTube, obviously. And a lot of people are watching. Since that big 1.6 million view video hit, What's your business been like?
It's just been, it's crazy. I mean, you talk about not having a pipeline full. Well, now it's over full. I mean, I've got buyers coming out my ears now. Unfortunately, like everywhere else, there's no inventory to sell them.
Right.
But it's a good problem to have. And I was telling you earlier, I get, and this is not an exaggeration, I get at least 3 calls or emails every single day because of my YouTube channel.
That's amazing.
Yeah. Organic. Like I said earlier, ever since I've gotten this business, I've been searching for a way that I don't have to bother people and that they call me, and I've finally found it.
And those aren't leads, you know, that they are, but they're not Facebook leads. They're not Zillow leads. It's not like you paid $200 per call to get those. You did a video, and like I say this with respect, a low budget video, you know, like you didn't have all the lighting and, you know, all the stuff, and a very low budget video shot on your iPhone that is now producing 3 calls a day, organic leads that are intentionally calling you instead of somebody else.
Yep.
That's amazing. Have you found, and you've done Facebook ads and stuff before, you've done some online leads. Are you noticing the quality of these are better than online leads, or, you know, speak to that a little bit?
Yeah. And back to the celebrity thing, if you want to call it that, you know, when people watch you, I had a call right before I got on this with you from a gal in Florida. Oh, we were up all last night watching all your videos, and I'm like, must have been bored. But yeah. You know, they feel like they know you. They connect with you, and again, it's like, not that I'm a celebrity by any means, but they have this connection to you that they don't from an ad, you know, whether it's on Facebook or wherever, a billboard, pick an advertising medium. When you're standing there talking, like on my viral video, and I'm just standing on the side of the road, you know, people can relate, or they feel like they know you, you know, and I kind of joked around in that video. I made a comment that, and it is true that in Bozeman, Montana, so many Californians have moved up there. It's now known as Bozangeles around the state. So I get calls now from people saying, oh, I'm not, you know, I'm from California, I'm sorry. And, you know.
Sorry, but I'm coming anyways, Will. I don't blame him.
So
my wife and I love Yellowstone, the movie or the show. And yeah, we're pissed at that series finale. Now we have to wait to find out who, how did that show affect the real estate market there in the Whitefish Bozeman area?
Well, you know, it's funny. I did do a video on the Bitterroot Valley where that is filmed, where that ranch actually sits. And by the way, if anyone looks that one up, that video was when I got my new editing software. So that one is really bad. But anyway,
was that your video? You showed that it's like right off the road. Like it's not
it's right off the highway.
Yeah. It's not remote at all.
Right off the highway. So it's Hollywood magic. It's just classic that when you watch that show, you think that they're out in the middle of nowhere, like I was talking about earlier, but they're right along the road. And, you can drive right past it on Highway 93. If you ever, you know, come to Montana, it's right there. And it's actually when they're not filming, it's a bed and breakfast.
Really?
They rent that out. Yeah. So you can go stay there. But, so we get, you know, people, oh, I want to live in Montana because I watched Yellowstone. Sure. I mean, we are getting that. I don't think that's the big push. I think what has benefited our market or made it crazy is just the COVID thing. Our market was already growing before that, but everybody in the big cities that had been locked down and wanted to get away. And the other big thing too that people don't think about is a year ago, probably about to the day, there were a lot of people in this country that didn't realize they could work remotely.
Right.
And now there's a ton of people that live in big cities that are thinking, you know, why do I need to keep living in downtown LA when I could live up in the mountains of Montana or in Salt Lake or wherever? I mean, that's the that's, I think, is the real catalyst to our growth.
Sure. Okay. That makes sense. Yeah. California, Oregon, Washington, just, you know, COVID lockdowns and craziness. Yeah. And cost of living in those places too. They're like, wait, I can live in a more remote place, still have internet access, still get my job done. Why wouldn't I just go to, you know, go there? It's, I can relate to, you know, what you're feeling in your market, because when I got into this industry 10 years ago, Salt Lake was not a hot city. Like, it was not one of the hot markets at all. It was right after the Great Recession. There were, you know, bank owned properties and short sales everywhere. It was a very hot buyer's market. And, you know, you could buy a house in Salt Lake City for 65 grand. And now it'd be like 400. Maybe not that much for some of these homes, but still. And it's weird having grown up here and then to see how, like, the world shifted into your lap, so to speak. Like, I've always thought Salt Lake was an amazing place, but it wasn't until after the 2002 Olympics and then the Great Recession. And then all of a sudden, like, technology happened and Salt Lake becomes one of these hot cities. And I just happened to be in the real estate industry. And it's crazy to watch. And you've grown up, you've been in Montana for quite a while, right?
Yeah. 20 years. Yep.
Kind of the same thing where, like, you've always loved it and you're like, how come nobody else sees it? And now they all do. And it's kind of wild being in an industry where you're literally helping them, you know, realize that.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah. Same thing. We've always had growth here, but there's been nothing like what's going on now ever. And the other thing too, that, and I'm sure you'll see it out there too, you know, you're in Salt Lake, which is obviously is a major metro area where we don't have one of those in the whole state yet.
Right.
But like our valley, we have all the conveniences. We have good internet. We have high speed internet. We have hospitals, blah, blah, blah. But I think what is really going to change Montana is Elon Musk's, the Starlink, you know, when you can go out to that area I talked about earlier with the viral video and have high speed internet, that's opening up a whole new, you know, frontier of living, because you can have everything but still live way the hell out in the middle of nowhere.
Oh my God. Yeah. I haven't even thought of that yet. Yeah. Starlink's incredible and it's cheap. From what I've seen, it's cheaper than anything I'm paying right now for like four times the speeds. And it's coming down from a satellite. So it's like those remote places will now be fully connected with high speed. Yeah. And that's going to further change the landscape. So any agent listening that's in a small market or a rural market or whatever, like, the world's going to shift into your lap pretty soon. The same stuff that we're talking about right now, it's very feasible that it could happen to you, because cities are just getting ridiculous in a lot of different ways, politically and cost of living and crime and bullshit. And so just be ready for it. If you live in a place and you're like, how come this is such a well-kept secret? Pretty soon it's not going to be. But great point about Starlink. Like, that's going to be a big deal. And I know Facebook's working on some sort of, like, internet beaming down from the heavens type thing too, but I think that's more for like developing countries than here in the US. It's crazy. Absolutely crazy. Well, what else with YouTube have you learned over the last year or so that you really want anyone who hasn't started a YouTube channel, or they're just not doing so well? Like, what have you learned that you think people must know about success on YouTube?
I think the biggest thing, like I said earlier, just provide good information. People are searching YouTube to find out about your town because they may have to move there, or they're visiting, whatever it is, but they're on YouTube. They're searching YouTube. And obviously YouTube's owned by Google. So Google's providing videos as well. Even if people just Google Montana, my videos come up.
Right.
So that's another great thing about it. You know, and like I said, do your own research. It's not that hard to figure out. it just comes down to, like I said, provide good information, be real. You don't need fancy, you don't need to spend a ton of money. If you already have an iPhone, that's all you need. I mean, I bought a $25 tripod that I can mount my phone on, and I bought a little lapel mic for $20. And, you know, it was about $100, one of those gimbals, but that's it. So I've got less than $200 in equipment, but yet it's generated, you know, far beyond that. And, you know, people pay $200 a lead, like you said, on Zillow in some places. And, you know, I'm getting all these for free.
And they're better leads. They're just better
leads.
They
know you.
Yep. They know you, and they want to work with you. Yep. That's the part that's so understated, and it's hard to put a value on that. They're just better leads. You know, when they stay up all night and watch all of your videos, like that couple in Florida, they're not going to go hire Johnny with KW. They're going to hire you because they want to, you know, they saw you, they learned from you, they want to work with you. That's important. And I'm glad you mentioned that about the equipment too. For you guys on YouTube, like this mic, this is the second podcast I've done with this new mic. I used a $100 Blue Yeti mic for 169 episodes of this show.
You mean like this one?
Exactly. It more than sufficient, great sound. You just have to have a quiet room because it can pick up a mouse fart 3 blocks away if you're not careful. But you don't need a $250 mic. You don't need a $110 arm to hold it. You don't. Your phone can do literally anything. It's just, are you going to do it or not? And you've done it, and you're proving, Will, that you can get millions of views without a bunch of fancy, you know, cinematography and stuff like that. What would you say is the biggest misconception that you had before you started YouTube that, or what you wish you knew now, or what you wish you knew then that you do know now? You know, is there something that you're like, wow, that wasn't the case, that you think everyone should know?
Well, I guess the biggest thing that's a little different from what you're saying, that if I could go back and do it all over again, I would have started a YouTube channel 10 years ago. Hmm. And then that's the biggest thing. So if you're on the fence, just do it. The other thing that people get hung up on is, oh, I don't like to be on camera. Well, the way you need to think about it is, and my wife is one of them, I tell her all the time, if she was the face of our channel, we'd have 10 times the amount of subscribers, but she just won't do it. And she just feels uncomfortable on camera. And I don't understand why, because if you think about it this way, when you're sitting in your office and you have like a walk-in, a floor call, whatever, somebody walks in and they want to sit and talk to you about your market, basically they're looking at you. It's a video of you. They're watching you. They're watching you talk. They're looking at you, and you're totally comfortable with that. I don't understand why when you put a camera in front of somebody that they freak out and it's totally different. But I mean, it obviously is an issue.
For sure.
So that's the other thing. And again, all these gurus, do your own research, figure it out. It's not, you don't, again, I mean, it's not that complicated.
No, I've been, you know, I'm diving into YouTube now and taking it very seriously. And it's, once you learn a few basic concepts, then it's just improving on those over time. It's not rocket science. It's fairly simple. It just takes intentionality and consciously thinking things through. And some stuff is going to suck. Some's going to be great. Some stuff is going to suck, and then it becomes great 3 months later. All of a sudden, it's weird. Will, we're almost to top of the hour, and I want to be respectful of your time. Whenever we have a guest on, we do these rapid fire questions where you just pick one or the other. You don't need to elaborate unless you want to. And then at the end, we'll give people a chance to hear where they can find you and connect with you. And of course, we'll put links in the show notes and the YouTube description as well. You ready for rapid fire?
Well, I had one more thing I'd like to add, and I do have a couple minutes. You know, the book deal that happened.
Holy crap.
Because of
I probably should have. I'll mention that in the intro. How about that? So at least they're not waiting until the very end. Yeah. So tell us about what happened.
So again, some guy in Philadelphia was thinking of moving out here, started watching my channel. And it turns out he's a publisher that does these short books for businesses, or he helps businesses write these books. And again, he called. I had no idea who he was. He called about my video and we were talking. And I actually went to college at Penn State. And so I said, oh, I went to school in Pennsylvania, and we, you know, hit it off, because it turned out he was at Penn State at the same time I was 100 years ago. And so we just kind of hit it off, and I ended up just writing a book. He's been saying he wanted to get into the real estate end of things and help realtors and that are in nice places do these books. And so I just put together this book with him, and called Moving to Whitefish, Montana. And it just came out last week, and it's, we're kind of excited about it. So, and it's all because of YouTube.
So they found you and they're like, hey, let's do a book. And they handled all the, you know, book stuff. And you just provided the content and the name.
Yep. Yep. And most of it, I was talking to another gal that we both know the other day about it. She's interested in doing the same thing. I already had a blog with a lot of these articles in it, or chapters. And so my book was almost complete. I just needed somebody to put it together in an actual book form. And I mean, I did have to do some writing, but yeah, now it's an actual book.
Amazing. So what's the plan? Are you going to show up to listing presentations with your book?
Well, yeah, for sure. You know, why not? Because now I can tell people, you know, I'm not sure why you wouldn't use us, but we wrote the book on it.
Exactly.
Which is a little cheesy, but you know, I think it's kind of funny.
It could work. Yep. I think that's pretty cool that just the doors that have opened because you started to talk to a camera and you put it on the internet.
Yep.
Like that's really what you did. Very cool, Will. And we'll put a link to your book. We'll put a link to your social media and everything in the show notes, wherever you're listening to the podcast, or the YouTube description if you're watching on YouTube. Let's do these rapid fires and then wrap it up.
Okay.
All right. Facebook or Instagram?
Facebook.
Facebook or LinkedIn?
I'd still have to go with, I use Facebook more.
Books or podcasts?
Books.
Books or audiobooks?
Books.
iPhone or Android?
iPhone.
Correct answer. Alexa or Google Home?
Alexa.
Burgers or pizza?
Pizza.
New York or LA?
LA.
LA or San Diego?
San Diego.
NFL or NBA?
That's not even close, NFL.
Football or baseball?
Football.
Mountains or beach?
Beach.
It's because you live in the mountains.
That's right.
Yeah. Podcasts or vlogs?
I kind of have to go with vlogs.
You must. You'll like the next one. YouTube or Facebook Live?
YouTube.
Rich dad, poor dad, or millionaire real estate agent?
I'll go with rich dad, poor dad.
Uber or Lyft?
Uber.
Gary V or Grant Cardone?
Gary V.
Nice. And give us an app recommendation. Are there any new apps or old apps that you are playing with that you spend a lot of time on?
My newest one is my wife and I are having a little competition. And so we both threw some money and got on the Robinhood app, and we're having a little stock competition on there. So that's my latest one in the last few weeks.
I love it. Little hot tip, buy EXPI immediately because it's down 50%.
Yeah. Well, unfortunately, when we got in, I've lost, you know, it's gone way down from when I bought. So I'm hoping it goes back up, but thanks for the tip.
Absolutely. Yep. It's all timing. A year or two from now, you'll be fine.
Well, it's like I told my wife, I knew that the day I had bought all my stocks on there, that was it, probably the pinnacle for 5 years. So Not recover. Five,
but for a bit, absolutely. Yeah, that's usually what happens. If I if I buy a stock and it's like, all right, let's put it all in on this one purchase, I guarantee it goes down. Like, I have to be like, okay, I'm going to buy some here and then some in a week or whatever. And it's weird. I don't know. Apparently, like, it's actually a thing. I forget what it's called. Well, I know what it's called. It's called bad luck. Or shitty stock picking tips, or shitty timing, or something. That's what it's called.
It's called. It's a good thing we didn't go into the stockbroker business.
Yes, exactly. Will, where can they find you, man?
Well, I'm on all the channels, all the social media. It'll be on. I think I sent you all the links. All the links are below.
Yep.
It's just you can type in YouTube. Living in Montana is our channel. You can just type my name into Amazon now and my book will come up. You can find me everywhere.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much, man. You're doing awesome things. It's really cool to see your evolution, you know, since we first met five years ago. A lot of success has come your way and you deserve every bit of it. Congratulations. Well,
thanks for having me on.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We'll talk to you soon, Will.
Okay.